nurse.
Good afternoon, everybody. Today, I'll be speaking briefly about transcranial direct current stimulation. Before that, I would like to thank my colleagues, Dr. Shivkumar and Dr. Dinakaran, for giving their valuable inputs in this presentation. This will be the outline of my presentation. First, let's briefly see the what is TDCS, history of it, its mechanism of action, indications, and how do we do it, and evidence for use of TDCS. In the later part, we'll see the side effects, precautions, as well as limitations. So let's come to what is transcranial direct current stimulation. It is a non-invasive neuromodulatory technique where direct current in the range of 0.5 to 2 milliampere is passed through the scalp by means of electrodes over designated areas of interest in an attempt to modulate the activity of specific brain regions. As we see, this is one of the examples of TDCS. Let's briefly see the history of TDCS. I just wanted to ask, anyone aware of this torpedo fish? Anyone from the audience?
What fish?
Torpedo fish.
I don't know torpedo fish, but anybody, if you know, Selena is asking, torpedo fish, Arun might be knowing. Arun, do you know torpedo fish something?
So torpedo fish is a fish found in tropical and temperate regions. It is very famous for its spontaneous electrical discharges. So how is it significant is Scribonius Largus, who is a court physician in Roman Empire. He used this live torpedo fish over the scalp to deliver strong electric current to relieve his headache. This is the beginning of TDCS. Then later, Aldini had assessed the effect of galvanic head current on himself. Aldini and Volta successfully treated patients with melancholia using this brain stimulation. The use of low density DC was progressively abandoned in the 1930s, as we all know, the Serletti and Binney's electroconvulsive therapy invention. However, Nishi and Polis, because of their work, this modulating cortical excitability by TDCS came into effect and broader research was done on that. So this is the, historical wise, the torpedo fish by Largus, how he is stimulating his scalp. And this is the earlier brain stimulation therapy. Let's see how does it work. What are the immediate effects? Actually, as we know, there is anode as well as cathode. So anode will be excitatory and cathode will be inhibitory. But what we focus more on this is it either excites or suppresses only resting membrane potential. That means it doesn't create action potential. This we have to focus because whereas in transcranial magnetic stimulation and all, it will be the action potential where it is only resting membrane potential is either excited or suppressed. What are the intermediate effects? It modifies the synaptic microenvironment. How does it do? It is due to NMDA and GABAergic activity. Delayed effect or neurotransmitter changes occur in the synapse. What is the late effect? Neuroplasticity occurs. As we all know, neuroplasticity is the ability to reform as well as formation of synaptic connections secondary to the lifetime experiences or learning, or it is can be due to injury also. That happens either by long-term potentiation or long-term depression. The neurotransmitters and mechanism involved are by altering cyclic AMP, calcium, synaptic protein channels, and brain-derived neurotrophic factor, along with increased mRNA and protein synthesis. Effects of TDCS persist after stimulation ends. Longer stimulation shows slower return to baseline, usually. So to summarize, it modulates cortical excitability in a polarity-dependent fashion, and anode increases, cathode decreases. Changes in cortical excitability are dependent on current density and stimulation duration. Immediate effects of TDCS are due to modulation of neuronal membrane potentials. Long-term effects are due to NMDA receptor-dependent mechanisms. So this is the standard TDCS device where there is an anode, which is red in color, cathode, which is blue in color, and the leads for electrodes, as well as a battery device. So parameters. Parameters mainly involved are the size of the electrodes, electrode positioning, intensity and duration of stimulation, number of sessions per day, interval between sessions, different physiological and adverse effect profile by how we vary, I mean by varying them. And TDC was, for your information, TDCS devices are not standardized worldwide. So parameters of stimulation here, I'll be mentioning about which are commonly used. Duration will be 5 minutes to 30 minutes of stimulation. Intensity will be 0.5 milliampere to 2 milliampere. Size of electrode usually will be 20 centimeters square to 35 centimeters square. Scalp surface current density will be 24 microampere per centimeter square to 29 microampere per centimeter square. Site of stimulation, it varies depending upon the clinical situation. Usually dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, motor cortex, visual cortex, somatosensory cortex, it varies depending on the condition. And here I have, can you see this ramp up and ramp down? This is also important because ramp up phase, there will be a gradual increase in the intensity of the stimulation. So what is the importance of this is, if there is sudden increase in intensity, patient will experience a lot of side effects and they will experience some discomfort. So around 30 seconds of time is given for gradual increase and gradual decrease also. That is ramp up and ramp down. So to as I think I don't want to explain more on this, as Dr. Jayanth in the previous session has clearly taken this thing. To briefly say, F3 and F4 is for dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and C3 corresponds to motor cortex. So what are the indications of TDCS? So because of time constraints, in my future slides, I'll be discussing more on psychiatry part, whereas neurological indications are, especially in post-stroke rehabilitation, it is more studied to improve motor symptoms, cognitive problems, and speech deficits. And it has good evidence in terms of aphasia. Parkinsonism also, and tinnitus, fibromyalgia, it also enhances cognitive performance and learning. It is also used in the treatment of migraine, as we can remember the torpedo fish with Largus. So psychiatry for depression, schizophrenia, substance use and craving management, OCD, mild cognitive impairment, and for etiological research. Let's come to the procedure for TDCS. Before planning for a TDCS, there should be an appropriate indication. For example, in terms of alcohol use to decrease craving or to increase the time for relapse, or in terms of schizophrenia, whether to decrease the auditory hallucinations, which are not responding well to antipsychotic. So appropriate indication should be there. Then later we have to offer the treatment option, TDCS. It can be offered on outpatient basis as well as inpatient basis. And before giving it, we should give adequate information provided and video of the TDCS procedure should be shown. As we all know, TDCS in the research and it's predominantly used for research. So adequate information and consent is very important and demonstration of the video is also very important. If patient responds and agrees, we have to prepare the skin and electrodes. This is to to decrease the resistance level. So in the skin, we will apply the jelly for the safe, better conduction, and electrodes will be soaked in a saline for better conduction without any resistance, to decrease the resistance. TDCS was given using the standard equipment as we saw earlier. I'll briefly discuss about TDCS in schizophrenia. In schizophrenia, as we know, that auditory hallucinations are the main irritable thing which people face, which they predominantly complain. So the inhibitory should go to temporoparietal junction. That is midway between T3 and P3 of the 1020 EEG system. And anode placed over left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, which will be stimulatory. So the as I will not be repeating, 35 centimeter square electrodes is used for most of the TDCS procedure, and stimulation intensity usually 2 milliampere. And duration, we usually use for schizophrenia, it's 20 minutes and twice daily sessions for 5 days. It is useful in the treatment of auditory hallucinations resistant to antipsychotic treatment. It also improves insight, negative and cognitive symptoms. Towards the end, we can ask Dr. Dinakaran to speak about this. His thesis, he has done expert in, he's an expert in this field and his thesis is also on this. Let's move on to TDCS in depression. In TDCS in depression, the anode, that is stimulatory, will be placed over left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. As we know, if stimulation of left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex will improve the depression. So as I said, the electrodes and stimulation intensity is same, whereas it is once daily session for 10 days and duration of stimulation is 30 minutes. let's come to TDCS in OCD. In OCD, before that, I would like to say, response inhibition will be affected in patients with OCD, and it is an endogenous marker. So improvement in response inhibition is found to have improvement in clinical symptoms also. So in that way, we are using that in as a improvement, prognostic indicator in terms of symptom in OCD. So in OCD, anode is placed over left pre-sublimentary area, that is anterior to motor cortex, and midpoint of inner edge of electrode is placed over FZ of 10-20 EG system. And cathode will be placed over right supraorbital area. So in this also, twice daily sessions for 5 days with an interval gap of 3 hours, and same electrode 35 centimeter square, intensity of 2 milliampere, and duration 20 minutes. And it was found to decrease symptom severity, and it improves response inhibition. Next, for mild cognitive impairment. In this, the anode is placed over left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and 35 centimeter square electrode with current density 0.06 milliampere per centimeter square, and cathode placed over right supraorbital area, 100 centimeter square electrode, current density of 0.02 milliampere per centimeter square. Stimulus intensity is same, 2 milliampere, duration of 20 minutes for 5 days. Coming to TDCS in substance use disorders. As we all know about these pathways, dopamine pathway, which is mainly involved in reward, pleasure, euphoria, decision making, and motor function. And this white color pathway, which is serotonin pathway, which improves mood, modulates mood, memory, sleep, and cognition. So as we all can see, prefrontal cortex, hippocampus, nucleus accumbens, ventral tegmental area, and raphe nucleus. White is the serotonergic pathway, and dopaminergic pathway is red. So TDCS in craving. Dopamine-containing neurons are located deep in the brainstem. So it is very much difficult to get access to those areas using direct current stimulation. So what we are doing is, we are going to bring it to the accessibility by an indirect manner. As you can see, this dorsolateral prefrontal cortex have monosynaptic projections to ventral tegmental area. So this is very important, because through that, through stimulation through dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, we are going to modulate, and we are going to, that reward pathway, craving, everything is going to get modulated because of this. Monosynaptic projections to ventral tegmental area from DLPFC. So DLPFC activation reinforces drug avoiding behavior, and TDCS disrupts the drug craving network. DLPFC stimulation might mimic craving related processes and thus reduce necessity for reward related behavior. So for substance use, as similar to earlier studies, 35 centimeter square electrode is used, 2 milliampere intensity of stimulation, once daily session for 5 days, and the stimulation duration is 20 minutes. Here anode is placed over right dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, that is F4 of 1020 EG system, and left DLPFC for cathode, which corresponds to F3. Studies were done on nicotine dependence syndrome. Major subjects of study are craving, drug-seeking behavior, and related expectations and relapse. And it was found that TDCS will modulate smoking-related Q-reactivity. So Q-reactivity, Q-related responses, as we know, because of classical conditioning, whenever a substance-related Q is there, they will get the desire to take the substance. So Q-related reactivity is assessed by the brain areas, how the changes in the brain areas through functional MRI and all. So coming to alcohol, it was a study done by Boggio et al. In which 35 alcoholic subjects were recruited, both anodal left and cathodal right, and anodal right and cathodal left significantly decreased alcohol craving compared to sham stimulation. Sham stimulation is that it will be, the stimulation duration will be only for brief period. Rest of the time, actually the patients will not be getting stimulation. This is to rule out the placebo effect in research. So 18 of them were under sham TDCS and 17 were under actual TDCS, and daily sessions of 5 consecutive days were given. And in the follow-up, they assessed the craving using the following scales. As you can see, obsessive-compulsive compulsive drinking related craving. So all these things they assessed, and once weekly they assessed for first 4 weeks. After that, once in a month for 5 months. So it's a 6 month totally follow-up study. And the results are, by the end of the 6 months of follow-up, 2 subjects treated with sham and 8 treated with real TDCS were still alcohol abstinent. So 8 was a good promising result. Other substances, transcranial direct current stimulation of prefrontal cortex was also found to modulate the desire for specific foods in a study by Frenny et al. In 2008. And it also decreases craving for cocaine and decreases anxiety in cocaine uses. Studies done in NIMHANS, I'll briefly tell about 2 studies. By Vinita et al. Did a study to see how far the time to relapse and how far is the decrease in craving secondary to TDCS stimulation of dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. Positive results of time to relapse into alcohol use and better inhibitory control was found in her study. However, there was no statistically significant decrease in craving. And another study by Jitendriya et al., which looked into the alcohol cue-induced brain activation patterns using blood oxygen level dependent functional MRI and changes in central glutamate activity using MR spectroscopy techniques, that is before TDCS baseline and after 5 days of TDCS treatment was assessed. It was found to improve executive control over reward structures, gets translated into longer time to alcohol lapse. This again reminds us of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex monosynaptic connections to this areas, nucleus, accumbens and all. Ventral TDCS stimulation parameters, I'm not going to repeat it. This is a brief summary of whatever I have mentioned regarding the parameters for different various clinical conditions predominantly used in psychiatry. Let me move to the next slide. So what are the adverse effects? Commonly reported adverse effects are mild tingling, burning, as well as itching sensation. Nausea, it is usually reported when the electrode is placed over mastoid area because of the close approximation with the vestibular apparatus. Headache is also another side effect, dizziness, and phosphenes are transient flashes of lights, which is commonly reported when electrode is placed near the eyes. Usually safe even in skin conditions like vitiligo, safe in pediatric and pregnant groups. However, long-term safety has yet to be established. Safety measures. These are some of the safety measures which we have to ensure before giving TDCS. Current amplitude should be within the range of 1 to 2 milliampere. Current density in the range of 0.029 to 0.08 milliampere per centimeter square. Current density of 142.9 ampere per meter square, delivering a charge density of 52,400 coulomb per meter square, is the critical limit in animal studies for brain damage. No time limit as such, but usually duration of 20 to 30 minutes has shown good positive results. Gaps between sessions is also very important. Patients should be warned of the minimal side effects. I would like to mention about the TDCS side effect assessment questionnaire is also there. With that, after the session, usually a scientist will assess it. And ramping up, which I told, which will minimize the discomfort for 30 seconds, gradual increase in intensity of stimulation. What are the limitations? We should be very cautious in uncontrolled epilepsy. However, there are some positive results in uncontrolled epilepsy in children where they give TDCS. But what I understood is, if we are target specific, then there is no issue. But some amount of discharges to others area in patients with known case of epilepsy can lead to epileptic discharges. However, if target specific, I think the issue is not a big thing. And it was found that in people without any history of epilepsy, it is not found to worsen or to cause any epileptic discharges. Subjects must have no metallic implants near the electrodes. Acute eczematous skin lesions because conduction will not be good. And stimulation of deeper brain structures, as I told, target specificity. Sometimes deeper brain structures might get stimulated, especially cerebellum and all. And patients with significant aggression who are not cooperative, this procedure can't be done. Let's see about high definition TDCS. So to overcome the limitation, to be more target specific, this high definition TDCS has been introduced. And what does it is, more than two smaller sized gel electrodes are used to target specific cortical structures. So in a pilot study, it was found to have greater long lasting motor cortex excitability changes than usual sponge TDCS. And if it is better integrated with EEG and fMRI, it will be more target specific and it will give better results. So conclusion, TDCS has the potential to induce clinically relevant behavioral changes. Further evidence of its efficacy from large-scale multicentric RCT is required. I'll just briefly mention about Projak et al., who is doing a multicentric trial, large-scale, around 300 and something, 300 to 400 within that sample size, RCT in multicentric trial. And we are expecting the results of it. Optimized research methodology, need for further investigative TDCS studies to understand the mechanism of action.